So I'm Frank Hammer, I'm from Detroit. And we were going to have a little bit of a conversation, and I hope maybe we'll do it after we take a break, about this wonderful solidarity campaign that took place in January and February, and exploit workers and laborers, whether they be in Colombia, whether they be in China now, wherever. The corporate empire goes everywhere and exploits labor throughout the world and undermines our labor in the process. But really what's happened over the last 20, 30, 40 years is the privatization of what have been our public assets. Our public domain is being shrunk, and it's being done at lightning speed. And we can see that in a place like the city of Detroit, and I'm sure that most of you in the cities where you come from can say very similar stories. That in Detroit, the bankruptcy of the biggest city, the biggest bankruptcy of any city in U.S. history, which befell my city in 2013, not too long after the bankruptcy that hit the two auto companies, my company, GM and Chrysler, are instruments that are being used to take things away that have been part of the public domain, that have been under public control, that have been provided as a service, and have been turned into private assets where corporations can produce products that can be profit-making for them and diminish the power that we have over those assets. That's privatization. And one of the biggest battles that has been waged in Detroit and sister city like Flint has been over the control of water. And I think that, I'm sure, somewhere along the way, you heard that water will be to the 21st century what oil was to the 20th. That water is going to be this resource that is going to be capitalized, that it's going to be commodified, and that we will, and it's really just amazing. I just saw an ad in the city of Detroit on TV talking about how they're providing water as a product. And they're using the word product as a way of creating the ideological terrain for people to accept the idea that water is a product and not a service. So the story of Flint and the story of Detroit are intertwined in regards to the question of water. What happened in Flint was part of a privatization scheme that involved both cities. And the only mechanism for doing that was to install a series of emergency managers. A nice way to talk about installing dictators, which is exactly what they are, because they have no accountability to the public, they have no accountability to voters, they are instruments of the state government, they've taken over all cities in Michigan that are Afro-centered, that are African-American majority, minority-majority cities. And they have done that in order to go after the assets, whether it be education under DeVos and the privatization of schools in Michigan. 80% of the charter schools in Michigan are now run by private companies. And in regards to the water, they have wanted to take control of the water away from the city of Detroit for many, many, many years. And the bankruptcy was the means by which they used that crisis in order to begin to transfer control over the city of Detroit water, which supplies the region, into something they call the Great Lakes Water Authority. And behind that is a corporation in France called Veolia that has got its eyes set on becoming the controllers of the water supply, and they will sell it to us for a profit. How does Flint figure in? So there was an emergency manager assigned to Flint, and one of his tasks was to begin to make the move by cutting Flint from the Detroit water supply. That was designed to cripple the Detroit Water Authority, the Detroit water system, and begin to create another source of water in Lake Huron, and I don't remember the name of the authority, but in the making that move, Flint was returned to its own, to the using the waters from the Flint River. Now, if you've any of you have ever been to Flint, it's GM corporate town. And the Flint River is polluted by the manufacturing operations of General Motors. And so when they made that move, they made it without taking care of this polluted water, so that when it entered into the lead pipes, it wouldn't leach the lead out of these old systems, so that it actually began to poison all the families in Flint, and many retired auto workers and many workers' children who are now contaminated with lead poisoning, which has, as you know, lifelong effects in terms of learning disabilities, personality disorders, et cetera, et cetera. And that is what the people in Flint are now living with. Never mind that their wealth has been diminished by virtue of the fact of the loss of the property values of their homes, just a calamity, absolute calamity, which can be blamed directly on our version of your Illinois governor, Governor Snyder in Michigan. Just as an aside, GM, when the water was converted to the Flint River, GM was one of the first ones commercially that complained to the government that said, we cannot be operating off this water from the Flint River because it's corrupting our engine parts. It's corrupting our engine parts. It's corrosive. And we have to go back to the other water system, which the governor did at the cost of about $400,000 a month. They allowed General Motors to go back to the other water system. And even though there were groups like us in Flint complaining about the water, nothing happened to the Flint, for the people, all the while the GM was put on a different system. And with utter and complete shame, I want to tell you that the UAW said nothing. In Flint, are the home of the UAW, never mind the role of South Bend, the home of the UAW. There was water brought in bottles into the manufacturing plant, into the engine plant. And even members of the UAW local there and the local union didn't say, well, what about the people in our community? And I only say that, not because I want to put blame on, but I want to say, our union has been corroded. Our unions have been corroded. The spirit of commonality, the spirit of solidarity, has been so corroded that even the water that was brought into the Flint plant, it didn't alert people to say, well, what about our community? So, they're going to privatize Flint water. That was the direction. They're going to privatize the Detroit water system. And in order to do that, I know, just a little bit more, they're raising the rates of water supply in Detroit. And there's a whole lot of poor people that live in Detroit that can't pay for the rise in rates. And what happens after a while is that the water bills that are not getting paid are being attached to property taxes. And if you're not paying your property taxes, you stand to be, over a period of time, foreclosed upon and evicted. So we have water cutoffs going on in the city of Detroit that are going at the rate of about $3,000 a week. Foreclosures are going on, and I'm forgetting now what the rates are. I don't remember the numbers. But they're massive in the move to privatize the water system and to make it attractive for the Veolia-type corporation to come in and take it over. So this is the challenge that we're facing in the privatization, whether it be the schools, whether it be the water, you name it. It's just another avenue for profit-making for the corporations and a diminishment of the public domain and the public control of services that are human rights, I mean, just like healthcare.
So I wasn't prepared to really talk about the subject.
I really appreciate that you invited me to say this, but I think that this is a monumental struggle that unions, it was used earlier, and I really appreciate hearing all of the things that I've heard this morning about shared governance. I mean, that's kind of another way of describing the role of the UAW today about, you know, shared governance, okay? But I do want to add that once the crisis emerged in Flint, two things happened. One, UAW GM resorted to using joint funds to fork over $3 million to help Flint. And the other thing that happened, and it needs to be pointed out, is UAW locals in Flint and elsewhere really stepped up to the challenge in terms of responding to the emergency of supplying water to residents. And that's a bit of a crisis now going on now, which I won't go into, but I just want to say that, again, in that instance, it was rank and file that finally, you know, came to the fore and actually came to the aid of Flint workers and families. A little bit too little, a little bit maybe too late, but I want to definitely say that it's really about rank and file that ultimately.
I think Steve and I understand more about solidarity than most people do. We have been the benefactors of solidarity, not only in America, but across the globe. In the Staley struggle, which lasted almost 3 years, one of the key elements of our struggle was helping our membership survive with the food and pantry program, with medical assistance, an adopt-a-family program, and taking care of our members' needs and to help them survive. Give me one, Dave, if you will.
Sure.
To help them survive a lockout that we had no knowledge of how long it was going to last. So we put together a number of programs. From the campaign justice office. We had a small organizing office where we kept our flyers. We had computers, we had phones. We had people set up in there to answer calls. And we had a program called an Adopt-a-Family program. Well, we had a group of people that in the beginning it was somewhere around 60 to 70 that traveled across the country to Canada. I personally traveled to Europe. And we would go out, speak in union halls, at conferences, social organizations, churches, whatever it took to try to get the support of working people and you know, socially oriented groups, no matter where they were at, and to become part of our struggle. We had a religious coalition that's, and the first arrest at the gates of Staley's saw a number of Catholic nuns, a couple of priests, some Baptist ministers, and a Methodist minister get arrested at the gates of Staley, along with the entire leadership of the Caterpillar local. So our road warriors were charged with going out, speaking, raising money, drawing support, and eliciting, you know, support, like doing things like handbilling for us, creating pickets across the globe, and creating a support group network. So through those networks and the support group network, when a road warrior went out and spoke at a central labor council or a union hall, he took the names of people that he met and talked to, or they did, and we kept that information and compiled it. And then we would reach out to these cities, to activists in those cities, and say, hey, would you form a support group in our behalf and join our struggle? And here's what you can do. You can raise money for us in our absence. You can hand bill against our customers like PepsiCo and Coke. You can picket successfully without getting in any trouble or not breaking the law. Or if you want to, what the hell? But it got really creative. It got so creative it scared the hell out of our international union, who was desperately trying to sell us out, and eventually did. But in the interim, we raised nearly $2 million to buy all the food, the medical assistance, make house payments, car payments, whatever it took to support our members. Because if your members get hungry, they give up, they lose hope. And that's what we were trying to avoid. Like I said, we started out on what we thought might be a 30-day lockout, you know. We didn't strike, they locked us out. But most of us had the good sense to know that it was going to be a lengthy struggle because it involved not only the multinational of Tate & Lyle PLC from London, England, who had bought out AE Staley, but it involved the entire industry, Archer Daniels Midland, Cargill, CPC, American Maize. They were all in on it, not to mention the entire Republican Party. So we decided that we would sustain ourselves for the long haul. We hired Ray Rogers from Corporate Campaign to do a lot of our leaflets and flyers, to do research. We brought Jerry Tucker in, our dissident UAW member, to come in and teach in-plant strategy. So that for the first year that we were without a contract, we fought inside the plant. We literally stripped the management of their ability to manage that plant. Yeah. We disrupted meetings. We marched, we struck, and went back to work shortly thereafter. We worked to rule. You'd be surprised how many things can go wrong when the management's not there at every moment to tell you what to do when you can't think for yourself anymore. That's why they locked us out. So among the programs that we developed, and the one that's on this flyer, and I wrote these so you can take these, scan them to your computer, and you can reach out to other unions in trouble and say, hey, here's a program that'll help you sustain your members. And that's what we try to teach at the Warzone Foundation. We've been in business, small nonprofit, my wife and I, Steve, and a few others, and we assist local unions on how to fight back. We teach locals how to use programs like these to sustain their members. We also have, unfortunately, had the pleasure of representing individual members in internal disputes when their union wrongfully comes after them and tries to harm them because they stood up or they did the right thing. So I've been involved with a number of internal trials in different unions. And I never really feel very welcome when I face off with the International Union's attorney and their executive board when they're trying to cram it down the throat of some poor member who just did the right thing. So our Adopt a Family program is one of the programs that we offer. And you can offer it too. These programs are free. We want you to use them. But the Adopt a Family program, we come up with a figure. We were getting $60 a week strike pay. We were so wealthy that it was unbelievable. So we figured $600 a month for the average family. And the $600 a month would be given by a local union, an organization, or if they could not afford $600, we might take $200 from this local and $300 from that local and $100 from another. So that family got adopted. And hopefully it was be for 6 months, a year, or the length of the struggle. And we never had anybody really drop out of the program that was providing funds. This freed that family up to work on behalf of the union, to travel the country raising money, to picket, to demonstrate, to handbill, you know, and do their picket duty as well, along with the food and assistance program that we had. Now, the Road Warrior program that we had was the one where the members actually went out and spoke at union halls and showed videos and traveled and raised money and conducted pickets and demonstrations and you can have a lot of fun doing that as well. You don't have to be sad because you're in the middle of the struggle. You'd be surprised in your face and kicking him in the groin feels pretty darn good sometimes. But part of the Adopt a Family program you'll see on here is a sample financial disclosure form. And what we did is our program comprised of two or three members to operate the program in secret. Nobody needed to know who was adopted and who wasn't. If you want to get members mad or jealous over something, let them find out something, somebody's getting something they're not. So it's important that you keep this program secret. Not even the local leadership knew who was adopted. And whenever the program came to an end, we shut it down, we destroyed the files. None of this was taxable income, nobody needed to know. So we protected, you know, the privacy of the people that was involved in it. And we had our committee go through these folks, and they took a look at what kind of income they had, what kind of financial hardship they had. We asked people to list that. Once again, this was all confidential. Only the committee knew. And they made the decision, and they were rank and file members. They weren't officers of the union. This was a rank and file driven program. And they made the decision who got adopted. That way the leadership, you know, could not be blamed for playing favorites or whatever. That's an important part of it. On the road warrior organizing plan, we went out and spoke, showed videos. We hit to all kinds of conferences around the country. And we also used that program to reach out when Lane Kirkland came up and was challenged for election. We used that program to indict his poor leadership around the country. That culminated in Chicago when we had a video and an audio tape of him trashing our struggle, and he had to stand up on the stage to try to defend himself. And whenever we had the video held up by a member, Donahue grabbed Kirkland by the arm and led him off the stage. The next morning he resigned. Among the things that we do when you have a road warrior program and you have people that's going out to speak, you never want to talk internal politics, even though you know it's really great now here, what your international union is doing. But that we had a campaign office, we had phones, we had a computer to send out thank yous, we had newsletters, we had a mail system to mail stuff out, we had boxes of flyers in there and videos, T-shirts and sweatshirts that road warriors took on the road with them and did as much as they could. We would pay for their travel expenses, or a hosting local might put them up in their homes or rent a motel room for them or pay for the airfare. It all depends on what they could afford to do. And that's how we were able to raise that much money. The key thing is to remember that every one of these folks that went out, they gave up their time, their personal vehicles, and their family lives. They were all leaders, even though they were elected to nothing. They were volunteers. And you've got to remember that every one of these folks that go out there have leadership ability. They have potential. They just never got it recognized before. So the leadership has to step out of the way. Let these folks take the lead, take responsibility, and run their own programs. Got to have some oversight, certainly. But you can't tell them how to do their job when they're the ones doing it. It just doesn't work that well. But we ask them also to gather the information to help us build a support group network. We had, and on here you'll see a Campaign for Justice contact form, where we had them fill this out. It kept track of who gave the money and where we would send our thank yous, you know. And it gave people the opportunity to conduct a gate collection at their plant gates on our behalf. They could take a treasury donation. That's a way they could help. They could adopt a family. That's another way they could help. They could do an on-floor campaign to collect money for our local. But to help put together food caravans and gift caravans for kids at Christmas. We do that work today. We've been involved with more struggles than I can remember that we have actually tried to play a role in helping these striking or locked out workers. That's what we do in our spare time. So if you look at the contact form on the back, it's just pretty well common sense. And we use this international solidarity to to build that coalition with the UAW and the Firestone workers, who later became the United Steelworkers. And then finally, on the last program on here, is about building a solidarity support group network. And the Road Warriors are key in that, but a lot of that can be done with contacts that you have within the labor movement. Every union has a book that lists their local unions and the local officers. They like to keep them secret because they don't want you communicating with other unions, because when it comes time to sell you out, then you're going to go out there and spread the word on them, and they hate that. Well, we gave them a new wrinkle when it came to the UPIU, the United Paper Workers International Union, when they decided to sell us out. We picketed the International twice, and that went over real good. They brought me up, I think I had 12 charges against me, and they put me on trial. I filed counter charges, and I waxed their ass on every one of them. I then ran for international president, knowing I couldn't win, but it got me to the convention in Las Vegas, where I had to have a bodyguard or two. That wasn't the first bodyguard I've had. It was a trying time, but it was a learning experience. But it gave me hope that in this labor movement, there's enough people just like you in this room that we can rebuild it, and we must. Because the bureaucracy of the International Business Union is destroying the American labor movement. We don't need any help from corporate America, from Trump and Stein or Rauner Stein here in Illinois. The internationals are doing it themselves. And it, you know, it's historic. And I can tell you stories about the UAW, the machinist union. I've been involved with so many, it's unreal. And most of the time, they were betrayed by the international union or district councils, or regional councils, or bureaucrats that only cared about their own salaries, their own benefits, and their own positions of power. The one thing that makes them fail is because they refuse to recognize the power of individual workers, the ability of individual workers, and the leadership that lies within all of us. When we organize the organized and we decide that we're going to fight back, as I'm telling you, crawling won't get you any sore elbows and knees. That's all there is. I was really devastated morally when I saw the skilled trades recently all fighting for a spot under Donald Trump's desk, which he has already used, you know, and he's got labor on board. The skilled trades have a history in this country of thinking, and this goes back to the days when the FL-CIO split under John L. Lewis, when he punched the carpenter's president in the nose and split from the FL-CIO, because skilled trades never thought industrial unions were smart enough to, you know, or skilled enough to have a union. That's the mentality, and that's the mentality that's permeating the House of Labor today. You gotta ask yourself, with all that's going on in this country, you know, with the worst political climate we've seen in our lifetime, with corporate fascism taking control of this country at its very core and attacking we the people in this country, union and non-union, where in the hell is that new voice that Richard Trumka promised us when he got elected to the FL-CIO? Apparently, laryngitis goes with the office. I was there at the convention in 1995, at the AFL-CIO convention in New York. Steve was there. And we stood before Steve Jokic, the international vice-president of the UAW, who stood in front of us during the Caterpillar struggle. There was 250 illegally terminated members. And he told us, he said, I'm not going to hold up a contract for thousands of UAW members for a couple hundred UAW dissidents. That was Steve Jokic, international president. Well, it took them 6 years to get a contract, because the members refused to follow his lead and would not accept that contract until those members were reinstated. They shoved that contract back four times for a vote, and it was rejected four times, mostly because of the overwhelming no vote in Decatur, Illinois. I think the UAW has some of the finest membership in the country, but they have definitely got at the top in Solidarity House in Detroit the worst leadership of any union in this country. One more brief story. In 1999, we got a call from Henderson, Kentucky, at a plant down there. 650 members and their families were locked out at Accuride Wheat, a UAW organized plant. They had been organized, I think, like 15 years. Accuride was offering them, or demanding to them, the worst contract you could ever imagine in UAW history. Ron Gettelfinger was a regional director who later became UAW International President in Thief. And he promised to stand with them for as long as it takes. Well, they struck and they returned to work to keep being permanently replaced. Then the Accuride locked them out. It was an easy chance for a victory because those wheels went to White Freightliner in North Carolina. And Mack Truck, other unionized shops, UAW organized shops. All they had to do was say, we're not putting scab wheels on them trucks. That simple. But not for Steve Yovich. He was too busy playing golf with the president of Ford up at Black Lake, their retreat up in Michigan that the UAW owns. We went down, Jan and I did. We took a pickup load of food, sat down with Billy Robinson and the rest of his leadership team, and we discussed ways that we could help. So we contacted our labor videographers from around the country, supporters that we had, and we put Billy on the road speaking about what was going on in his plant. Well, after they were locked out for a period of time, the UAW stepped in, and without telling the local union, went to the company first a week in advance and told Accuride they were going to cut off their strike benefits and their health insurance. Now you talk about union traitors. That's what they were, traitors. So once they did that, Steve and I scratched our heads and we got to thinking, well, maybe we need to picket the UAW. So we organized a national picket to meet in Detroit with about, 300 people there. We picketed Solidarity House, first time in its history. We squared off with Detroit's police and with Jokic's private security, who threatened to arrest us if we stepped on union property. Gonna arrest his own members for going on union property. We got an attorney in Detroit to file a charge with the Public Review Board that handles internal disputes in the UAW between the members and the bureaucrats. Well, knowing that they were gonna lose that PRB case because it violated the Constitution, what they did, and the fact that we organized that rousing picket out there, Jokic went through the picket line several times, and I think we gave him the worst day he ever had in his life, I hope it was. They reinstated the benefits about a week later, at double the rate, because they knew they were going to have to pay back those back benefits that they illegally took away from the workers. That's how sure they were going to lose. But it was an in-your-face campaign, my kind of party. About 6 months later, Jokic decertified the local and walked away because they refused to surrender the Accuride wheel. 650 loyal union members and their families and extended families. So you can imagine that many people, you're talking about probably 2,000 people being impacted by a labor bureaucrat that literally stabbed him in the heart. Well, that doesn't say much for organizing in the South, because a lot of people know about it. That's just one of the struggles that I've engaged within the UAW. There's been a number of them. I don't pick them. It don't matter what union you belong to, or if you're even a union worker. If you're having trouble with an employer and you need assistance, legal advice, I can get you a lawyer, or I can tell you what's in the labor department codes, probably as good as anybody in this room. We'll do what we can to represent you. It doesn't make any difference who you are. We're here to help. So take this handout here and use it wherever you need it. There are people that need your help. No matter what struggle you're engaged in or what you're going through, somebody worse off than you.
10 months since the lockout began at South Bend's Honeywell plant, people from all over the nation continuing to speak up and stand tall in solidarity with union workers. ATU 57's Henry Fixler was at the demonstration earlier this afternoon and joins us live tonight from UAW Local 5 in South Bend. Haley, UAW Local 5, just one of two locations where workers were demonstrating today in Michigan.
That's right, Key. They started here before making their way over to the Honeywell plant. Now, UAW and Honeywell are set to resume their negotiations in just a couple of weeks. But the workers I spoke with today said they are anxious to get back to work. And the outpouring of support from people in Chicago and Detroit that came all the way here today is helping them stay strong. 80 years after the success of a sit-down strike that gave automobile workers a union of their own, for some, something still changed.
We're here to celebrate that today and make people realize the struggles that those folks had back in the 30s are really not different than the struggles we have today.
At the UAW Local 5 post Saturday afternoon in South Bend, hundreds flocked to show their support for the Honeywell workers who've been locked out since May 2016.
I'm here because I drove here from Detroit this morning because I want to support these workers, and I want them to be able to go back to the table with Honeywell and negotiate.
Frank Hammer is a retired UAW member, one of the many supporters who live out of state, but who felt it was important to stand behind those fighting for their work.
It's incumbent upon us to support workers wherever they are, because we think an injury to one is an injury to all.
An injury that has taken a toll on Michiana families.
10 months of a good paycheck and a good working job, I mean, kind of makes you feel a little worthless.
Tom Streeter is the vice president of UAW Local 9 in South Bend. In the days ahead of new negotiations with Honeywell, he says the commemorative rally is a perfect time to remember their roots and remind the community of all that is important today.
Want the community to understand that this is a lockout. We didn't walk out on our own. They escorted us out of the building. This is not a strike. And that's one of the hardest things I think to get across is that we didn't walk out the door.
It's tiring at times, but I talked with some of the members and they're kind of an inspiration to continue this fight.
It feels great. Solidarity is something you can only know by engaging in it, and that's what we have to do.
What was amazing about today is it wasn't just UAW members at the rally. There were steelworkers and other industry workers that came here to show their support. Now, as I mentioned, UAW and Honeywell are set to resume their negotiations on February 21st, and I'm told everyone here at UAW wants a good resolution. Live in South Bend tonight, Katie Fixler, ABC, D7 News.
This was, for the corporate media to give that kind of report is really, really exceptional. They didn't even get a word from Honeywell. It was totally a union-driven story. And it was very exciting. And the local and our efforts got a lot of coverage, not only like this, but also in the South Bend Tribune. And I think it spoke to the amount of support that this struggle was able to achieve in a relatively short amount of time. And I'm going to talk a little bit about that. Again, my name is Frank Hammer. I worked for GM for 32 years. I was a rank and file activist beginning in 1975 in a hydromatic Warren transmission. Well, actually, it was a Chevy Motor Division. 3,500 members. We organized a rank and file caucus there. Pretty much after 5 years of organizing, took over the local and engaged in the kind of democratic union that we all should have, where there's a lot of rank and file participation and a lot of education and a lot of debate. We were part of the New Directions movement with Jerry Tucker and went into the UAW conventions with a message. So that's a little bit of my roots. And I wanted to mention to all the GEO folks that were here telling dramatically about their story that I myself was once a teaching assistant and could really identify with their struggle and their situation, although in my case it was years ago. I want to say a little bit about Autoworkers Caravan. We formed in the wake of the bankruptcy of General Motors and Chrysler. And we got our name by virtue of organizing a caravan to go to Washington, D.C. on December 8th of 2008 to give a rank and file voice to the attacks that were being engaged in at that time against auto workers, blaming the auto workers essentially for the overnight decline of GM and Chrysler market share that was really coming out of Wall Street, but being blamed on the workers. And it was an instrument to use to force the auto workers union into making concessions after concession, including the abandoning the right to strike under first Bush and then Obama, so that by 2009, what the UAW looked like was very, very different than from before the bankruptcy. So the caravan organized a group of cars that we went to DC, we went to a press conference, and I want to point out something about our origins, that one of the first things that we announced at the press conference is that we were advocating conversion of the auto plants that were closing to production of wind turbines and solar panels and things for an economy that's going to be a lot more sustainable than the one that we inherited, the auto industry. And I want to be really mindful that any convention, any conference, any meeting such as this, that we as auto workers and workers in general need to address the billionaires' drive to make this planet inhabitable by the continued use of fossil fuels and the continuous contribution to greenhouse gases that are warming the planet and that are changing our climate radically. And we've witnessed all over the globe, we're certainly witnessing it in weather patterns that we're experiencing locally. And I think that this has got to be part of any rank and file democratic movement, that we have to address the question of climate change. So I'm very proud that the caravan had its roots in doing this. I want to say, just to give you a sense of our activity, that we've mostly organized amongst UAW members around conventions, most vocally around the question of one member, one vote, because the reason we have the kind of leadership that we have in UAW is it's because it's been one-party rule for approximately 7 years, with the exception of the challenge presented by Jerry Tucker during the New Directions movement. We've also worked to expose the issues in our industry by demonstrating at the auto shows annually in Detroit, talking about the issues confronting auto workers, for example, the whole question of the introduction of 2 and 3 and 4 multi-tier ravaging our solidarity and unity inside our plants and giving workers inferior wages, benefits, lack of pensions, etc. So we've been an active group fighting on behalf of the interests of auto workers. So it wasn't a far stretch from doing what we've been doing to this year. Instead of going to the auto show, we decided that we were going to come out to the brothers and sisters at Honeywell and lend support. And I want to back up and say a little bit about Honeywell. The Honeywell struggle came about after the workers rejected a contract proposal in May of 2016. The company gave the local union 3 weeks to negotiate a new contract. And by the way, there are two locals involved, Local 9 in South Bend and a smaller local, 1508 in near Albany, New York. I saw the contract proposal that Honeywell presented to UAW Local 9. It was their contract book with all the language redlined. Absolutely all the language was redlined. There was nothing that Honeywell wanted to keep intact in their agreement. Honeywell has a record of engaging in lockouts when it doesn't get what it wants. And I've learned all this as a result of having been involved in the campaign with South Bend. I learned a lot about a town called Metropolis in Illinois, where Honeywell locked out their workers, members of the Steelworkers Union, not once but twice, once for 14 months, once for 8 months. So it has a pattern of going after small locals and basically trying to undo them. This was the case when Honeywell, after the workers by a 90% vote, rejected the contract in May of 2016, that Honeywell, they were sending out letters of dear colleague this and dear colleague that, and the next thing they know, the workers were accused of trespassing and were walked out of their jobs on a lockout. So this was May. Solidarity efforts on behalf of that local and the local in Albany weren't initiated by the International Union. I know it's surprising for you to hear that, I know. On the contrary, and I want to point out that some of the members of Local 551 were way ahead on the curve on the question of what do we do when we have fellow workers who are on lockout. Local 551, and principally with Scott Holvison's leadership and Vicky and all the members that are here. For a minute I thought it was at the Local 551 meeting and we had a quorum. We might be able to make some motion here. They sprung into action, and within 2 days of the lockout, they were began to come down to South Bend and engage in acts of solidarity, including their local union contributing $1,000 maybe in May, another $1,000 in September. They had a motorcycle committee that had a caravan of motorcycles that went down in solidarity, organized fundraising for their Christmas by the time 8 months rolled around. Had a delegation that came down with gift certificates that were for the children of Local 9 members. So I think that the Local 51 set a real profound example of what we do when we... And the Auto Workers Caravan took their cues from Local 551. And in December, after now we have a second vote at the Honeywell, the vote was timed to coincide with unemployment compensation running out. And they figured, well, they have the workers pinned against the wall and figured they were going to get a ratification vote. While the UAW Local 9 leadership stood mute on the question of whether the contract should be ratified, the fact of the matter is that the International Union representative who attended the meeting advocated ratification. Well, to the international surprise, the local, having already been out 7-8 months, voted no again by 70%. The smaller local in Albany had voted for, but the South Bend local stood firm and rejected the agreement, even though their unemployment compensation was running out. They were receiving UAW strike benefits, it should be pointed out. So, in December, the way the Autoworker Caravan works is we basically have conference calls. And during our conference calls is when we engage and plan in our activity. And it was in the December conference call that we said, instead of going to the auto show, we're going to go and support our brothers and sisters at Honeywell. So we had a caravan that went off from Detroit, and we had a similar caravan coming down from Local 551 and went down to South Bend. It was one of those days that climate change is bringing on, which is these whiteouts. It was rather hazardous, a lot of trucks on their side and jackknifed and all that in on the way. And it was really a great moment to see where the members that came in solidarity met with the workers at their shift meetings. And it was probably one of the more democratic union meetings that I've witnessed in a while, where there was a lot of discussion and a lot of open dialogue about what do we do next, what are we going to do. We visited the picket line so-called, because it was not a strike. And I think one of the most important things that happened around that time, is, or on that day actually, is that we did an interview for an outfit called The Real News. And if you're not familiar with The Real News, I urge you to Google it. They are an absolutely independent media outlet, and The Real News produced the interview that we did with the two individuals that you saw in the video, with Todd Treader and Brian Rogers, who were the leaders of the local. And that was the way the word got out that, in fact, these workers were not on strike. These workers were locked out. And the community didn't know that. They always had in mind, oh, these workers are, they're just greedy union workers and they're out on strike. Was not the case. So, after the January 5th gathering and our solidarity work, we plan to do a sequel. And the sequel, and by the way, I think two things to the credit of Local 9 that kept them as strong as they were was the fact that in November of last year, they celebrated the 80th anniversary of, in fact, the first sit-down strike in the UAW in 1936 that preceded the sit-down strikes that are much more famous, which are the ones that took place in Flint the following month. The South Bend was in November and Flint was in December. And in fact, the South Bend sit-down was victorious after 6 days of occupation. So in talking to Scott Treader and Brian, they said that part of why they've been able to resist is we're not going to let this happen at this local that has such a heritage and union bravery and in union solidarity and in union struggle. And the other reason is that, too bad for Honeywell, that area was a high employment area. So a lot of the workers that got locked out were able to get jobs at other locations and able to sustain being locked out. And Honeywell miscalculated. They didn't figure that into the plan. So I think the second no vote was a bit of a shocker to Honeywell and probably to the UAW as well. They tried a third time, and this has not been publicized. The UAW rep came to Scott Treader and Brian and said, we want you to do a third vote right before the holiday. And you can tell the workers that if they vote yes this time, and not no change in the contract, if you vote yes, we'll pay them holiday pay and we'll bring the workers back in January. And to Treader's and Rogers' credit, they said, no change in the contract, we're not bringing this back. So this was really pretty remarkable. And, you know, it's a small local, it's fairly isolated. There's only about 320 members. So, and then by our fortune of good timing, we were there on January 5th, and then we vowed to come back on the anniversary of the Flint sit-down strike, which was on February 11th, which fell on a Saturday. And it was a remarkable change around of the amount of solidarity that we were able to build in just about a month. And it was due to the fact, and I want to mention that Lee Glossett, who is also sitting here, was an instrumental part of the solidarity campaign that got built for February 11th. And I want to go forward a little bit and say, it was only about 11 days after our event on February 11th that Honeywell came back to the table and agreed to renegotiate with the local nine members and the international and an arbitrator or mediator. And a few days after that, they actually got their agreement passed, and they're going back to work as we speak.
And Solidarity House called them up to Detroit to support.
Yeah, so let me tell a little bit more detail. So when we had our event on February 11th, it brought together UAW members from Chicago, Local 551. It brought in UAW members from Chrysler and Kokomo. It brought in folks from Detroit. Plus, we had the community of South Bend with the Teamsters, with the AFL-CIO Labor Council, Jobs and Justice, the churches. We had city council members. We had the mayor's representatives there. It was a whole community of labor, faith-based, and neighborhood that came together in this rally that you saw them reporting on that day, that I think probably convinced Honeywell and the UAW that this struggle was increasingly getting public support. And when I talked to Lee about our action at the Honeywell at the picket line, he said he never had seen it get so edgy as it got on that particular day. And it was very clear that our efforts to build solidarity gave the workers a different spirit when they got back out into the picket line. And it was not a tranquil thing, but it was edgy when these scab vans were coming out of the driveway.
When the scab vans came in, they did not get out of the way.
It was much more militant. And it was because they no longer were isolated. They were no longer confined in the bureaucratic machinations of the UAW. This was a grassroots, heartfelt solidarity that I think gave them a new energy. And in fact, Scott and Brian both said when we came on January 5th that we brought a breath of fresh air. And that meant reams to my way of thinking about what the effect was of the solidarity work that we did. So, and the way Lee put it, which I thought was really good, is they didn't crawl back to work. They walk back into work with a different sense of dignity about themselves after this 10-month lockout. So the other thing that that Todd and Brian said was, oh, we wish that this had happened months ago. And it really speaks to the question of under a Trump era, under a lockout situation, that the UAW leadership is not prepared at all to engage in the kinds of grassroots organizing. I mean, obviously, Local 551 should have learned about this struggle from the region or from the UAW International. They should have been called right away, hey, we need some help and assistance with the workers at Honeywell at Local 9. And that's not where it came from. It came from another UAW local. We're way ahead of where the bureaucracy is ever going to be. And that's where that grassroots solidarity is going to have to come from. It's not going to come from the leadership. They were there prepared to let those workers ratify a contract that would have been devastating to one of the founding locals of our union. So I'm going to turn your attention to something else because we were going to kind of do it as part of the second part of the agenda, but I'm going to incorporate it into my remarks here. And that is that while this is going on, the Autoworker Caravan and other folks have been engaged in a solidarity campaign on behalf of Colombian GM workers. And I think it goes to this question of how do we deal with, we're the USA, the companies are going all over the world, what do we do, how do we connect with foreign workers in such a way that we have solidarity globally? And that is one thing that is not happening at the hands of the union bureaucracy or the UAW leadership. It is something that we need to take the leadership of, and that is what we've been doing. So we have a situation where GM, and it's kind of very similar to Honeywell, where GM workers in Colombia who assemble for their domestic market, it's not a plant that came from US and went to Colombia, where they would be injured on the job because of inferior health and safety. Sorry?
And they would get fired on the spot.
And they get fired on the spot, thank you. Injured workers, GM finds a way of firing them and manipulating the medical records so that they cannot receive workers' comp, which the law would provide for them. So fired, no workers' comp, out of a job, unable to get employment elsewhere, some of the workers decided to resist. And they formed a tent encampment, not unsimilar to the tent shed that was built in front of Honeywell. And these workers, this happened in 2011, they have been at a tent encampment until now, 5 years later, still struggling to get a settlement with General Motors. And the difference is, the reason the Honeywell workers could get a contract is because they're a union and because there is collective bargaining. In Colombia, their unions have been smashed. There's no mechanism for collective bargaining. So the UAW has a role in this situation too. The UAW, a year after the encampment had already been in place, 22 days after 8 of the workers went on a hunger strike, 22 days, with their lips sewn shut, the UAW and General Motors showed up and figured out they had a problem. Joey Ashton, vice president over General Motors, the UAW, along with GM vice president, went down to Bogota and created a mock mediation. And for 3.5 days, met with these injured workers and their association that they formed and gave them a rotten first proposal and a rotten last offer. And when the workers said, look, we have medical expenses, we have injuries, we have to be able to sustain ourselves, and when they rejected the second offer, GM and the UAW packed their bags and went home and have never been back. Nor will you ever find anything in Solidarity magazine about these GM workers. And that has to do with what the GEO folks said earlier today about shared governance. Joey Ashton today is on the board of directors of General Motors Corporation. That's the first time that a UAW vice president ends up being a member of the GM board of directors. He's the one that was down there to create this mock settlement for GM workers in Colombia that was rejected. So it's a longer story. I don't want to take up more time. I am going to bring in some posters from that struggle that's going still ongoing at GM. I want to say that Scott Holison at the most recent UAW convention spoke very eloquently about the struggle on the floor of the convention. It's been really terrific to have UAW members who have continued to support the struggle there. We're going to continue to do it. They're still in the encampment today, and this is, I'm talking about approximately 2,500 days, some amazing amount of days. We've been sustaining them, helping them, and supporting them, and we are going to get them a settlement like we were able to get for the Honeywell workers, and that's going to conclude my report. Thank you.
Thank you, Steve. Thanks everyone for coming today. After all that we've listened to today, does anybody think that the war on workers is not real? Anybody? No, we know it's real. But the media only calls it war, class warfare, when we start to fight back. And that's what this conference is about. It's about starting to fight back. Governor Rauner is in attack mode. He refuses to sign a budget that was passed by the General Assembly simply because it doesn't include a right-to-work provision in it. He wants right-to-work so bad that he's willing to starve out the state of Illinois. Think about that. He's willing to not pass a budget so that schools are underfunded. School children are underfunded. So that mental health institutions are underfunded. So that daycare centers are underfunded. All to bust the union. We're a threat. Brothers and sisters, we are a threat to them. But we have to come together to be able to fight this battle and win it. And that's why we're here today. The GEO workers earlier today, they mentioned that most of the money for the university isn't from the state. Why is that? Why is a state university not funded by the state? And if it's not funded by the state, who is it funded by? It's funded by the oligarchs. It's funded by the people that are trying to steal our institutions from us. So we have to fight them back, and we have to put the pressure on our politicians to restore the funding for these institutions, these state universities. Because college tuition should be very low cost. It shouldn't be something that you have to pay thousands and thousands and thousands of dollars for. That you have to basically have a mortgage to come out of college before you've earned your first paycheck. That's wrong, and we have to fight it. That's why I backed Bernie Sanders when the presidential election. Taking away their tuition waivers is economic entrapment. And I'm sorry they're not here to listen to this right now, but taking away their tuition waivers is a way to route their money through the financial institutions that crushed our economy in 2008 and 2009. It's a way to make them enslaved to the bankers that have enslaved us. They talk about academic freedom and lack of academic freedom. All you have to do to understand that is to follow the money. When your school is based on the goodwill of a few billionaires contributing to it, there's strings attached. The state should be funding this school, not the billionaires. Now, at Local 551, the UAW, as we've learned today, as most of us have learned through our careers with Ford Motor Company, that are here from 551, is a top-down organization. They've crushed workers struggling at Caterpillar. They've crushed the workers' struggle at Accuride. They've tried to limit the workers' struggle at Honeywell. But through our grassroots efforts, we've been able to assist where we can. And it's through those grassroots efforts that we're going to have any chance to reform the labor movement. It's through meetings like this that we're going to have any chance whatsoever to make the labor movement something that means something again. We talked about the service model and the organizing model of unionism. My brothers and sisters that came with me today, they're understanding the organizing model of unionism. But the UAW wants to assert the service model of unionism, where you have some glorious leader that does everything for you. Brothers and sisters, I'm here to tell you that's not the way it works. When you rely on somebody else's, some other glorious leader to save you, then you're in the same position you're in with when you're counting on the boss to save you. It's one boss or the other. You got either the boss that's signing the paycheck or the boss that's the union leader that's supposed to be protecting your job. We have to work together to protect all of our jobs. An injury to one has to be an injury to all. The PR campaign, or lack thereof, the public workers, the public sector workers, have really taken this idea and moved forward with it. They link to their own struggles, the community struggles, the communities that they serve. We saw that so well with the Chicago Teachers Union strike in 2012. The parents and the teachers and the students all were working together to build the Chicago school system that the students deserve. They won that strike, they won that war, or won that battle, but the battle continues. Because the very following year, Democrat Rahm Emanuel closed 50 Chicago schools, throwing hundreds of teachers out of work and making students cross far away from their homes to go to school. They weren't neighborhood schools anymore. And if you know anything about the gang structure in Chicago, and you know the gangs are a root of economic lack of opportunity, because if you can't find a job, you got to get some money somewhere, and you sell drugs to do it. Well, when they close those schools, they force gang members to cross those lines. So now we see a spike in shootings in Chicago, and we can't figure out why. I think we know why, and I think it was intentional. And I think we know who we have to blame for that. Rahm Emanuel. We also must turn our attention to our international solidarity. And I hope to hear from my brother Herbert Claros very soon. It's important for us to think like the corporations think. The corporations, they're not nationalistic. They don't think about America first. They don't think about making America great. They think about making the corporation great.
That's right.
They'll go to Mexico, they'll go to Brazil, they'll go to Colombia, they'll go wherever they can go for the cheapest labor.
Yes.
It's only through organizing internationally that we are going to be able to combat the corporations. We have to use their tactics. I've talked with our international leadership till I was blue in the face about this very issue. I brought it up at every convention I've attended. When I went to the LUPA conference in 2008, I brought it up directly to President Gettelfinger at the time. What are you doing to build international solidarity? And what he tells me is, well, we joined the IMF, the International Metalworkers Foundation, or Federation. That's not or building solidarity. That's being part of a bureaucracy.
Yes.
We need to reach across on a grassroots level, across borders, We cannot think nationalistically as workers. When we think nationalistically as workers and we think about the Mexican worker coming across the border, we're diminishing ourselves as workers. We have to think of the Mexican worker as our brothers and sisters because they are. We have to have the ability to get involved in each other's struggles. And that's why when I found out that Honeywell had locked out UAW Local 9, I investigated it as soon as I could. The way I found out was through Facebook, to be perfectly honest. We had come to the aid of our brothers and sisters at Lear. You guys remember that? Okay, we were organizing a rally at the gates of the Lear factory that supplies the seats to our plant. And the International came to us and said, please don't do that. They did. They told me to back off because I was going to mess up their negotiations. So I did. I waited until they actually pulled the trigger on the strike. And we went out there. We went out there in force. There were a couple hundred of us on their picket line. There were probably more of us on their picket line than there were of them. Because an injury to one is an injury to all. And that's something we have to live by. Well, one of the workers at Lear is a Facebook friend of mine. And she told me that Honeywell was being locked out. They were being walked out. And she told me the name of a Honeywell worker over there, so I contacted him, friended him on Facebook, and pretty soon I'm finding out what's going on there. And a couple days later, a few of us made a trip out there to talk to the workers on the line and to find out what we can do. What do you need? What do you need from us? We're here for you, brothers. We're here for you, sisters. Tell us what we can do. And pretty soon, we were making regular trips out there. So then when it came apparent that they had voted down their second contract and that, they voted down their second contract, like Frank had said, just as they were losing their unemployment benefits. Now, this local has a proud history. And they were proud of that history, that 80 years ago they were the first sit-down strike in the UAW. They were very proud of that, and they should be. And that's why they voted that down. So it's up to us. Lee, you got something?
Can I just add one thing? They state in Indiana, under our esteemed vice president at that time, refused to give them unemployment. They said, well, you're on strike. And the UAW had to take lawyers and go to court, okay, and use up a lot of money. They didn't start getting unemployment until almost July. Mm-hmm.
Right. Mike Pence.
Mm-hmm.
Thank you, Vice President. Vice something.
Okay, so then so they got it from July and they got back pay.
They got back pay, but I mean, still.
So, you know, they were squeezing them. Our esteemed politicians were squeezing them from both sides. When we found out that their unemployment benefits had ran out and that we knew the holidays were approaching,
yes,
and we knew that they were in a tight spot, but they voted that contract down anyway. So we organized a collection in the plant. Several of the members that took up that collection are here. And we walked around the plant, inside the plant. This wasn't a gate collection where you stand at the gate and ask. No, this we went member to member. And we did the best we could to cover the entire plant. Didn't quite get there. We still have to build our network. We're still working on that organizing model, but we will get there. Okay, so I guess in conclusion, whenever there's a struggle, we need to be there. We need to come to their aid. whenever there's a struggle in the work, in the labor movement. That includes the fight for 15. That includes the immigration struggles. That includes being a part of our communities too. And through that, we're going to build the labor movement back to the glory that it once had.
All right. Thank you, friends. I'm so glad to be here. I'm sorry because I don't speak English very well. I'm not fluent, but I'm a leadership for the metal workers in Brazil. And like a leadership of the workers, I will try to speak because I think it's very important to try share if you us experience in Brazil. Okay? Yeah. I will try. Friends, my name is Herbert Claros. I am Vice President of Metal Workers of São José dos Campos. São José dos Campos is an industrial city in Brazil, near 7 kilometers to São Paulo, the big city of the South America. São Paulo is in Brazil is different to here because the unions in Brazil represent the sectors, the skills, and the region. My union is the São José dos Campos city, represent 40,000 workers, 40,000 workers. Is an important union in Brazil. Is have a history of traditional for fighting. Your history is have a since 30 years in the past against the dictatorship, military dictatorship in Brazil. This is the history of my union. This union represents the two biggest companies. One is Embraer, aircraft manufacturer, Brazilian. When I work, I'm aerospace. The Embraer have 16,000 workers. It's the biggest factory in Brazil. Like a Boeing here, but smaller than Boeing. But it's biggest to Brazil. In my union represents General Motors workers, American company, do you know? Very famous, famous in Brazil. In Brazil have three plants of General Motors. One in São Paulo, the old plants General Motors. Other in Gravataí, in the south of Brazil. And other in my city, São José. We would like to share some experience, Steve. I know Steve and the other friends here in the last Labor Notes conference last year. And Steve invited me to this meeting. I'm here to United States to this meeting. And last weekend I visited California, San Francisco, I'm in touch with the unionists and activists of California, teachers of San Francisco, Oakland, Longshore Union, students. And tomorrow I will go to Philadelphia to meet activists, friends of Labor Notes of Philadelphia, my friends, my colleagues. In Monday I will go to New York, 2 days in New York. Wednesday back to Brazil. I'm in New York because I have a friends have a campaign for defend the immigrants in New York, Brazilian immigrants, Mexico, Muslim, against the Muslim ban, the politics of Obama. For me, it's very important to hear on the first to feel about the American workers, the American unionists. Thinking about Trump, because in Brazil when Trump win, surprised the Brazilians. And Brazilian workers, Brazilian activists ask why, why, and now, what the politicals of this president for the Brazilian, for the Mexico, for Colombia, for workers, for the Syria, for workers for Palestine. is a question for the workers out of the United States. But when we hear this, for American workers, we have a big problem for this government. Because in the same case, in Brazil we have a government that to try attack the workers. Like to hear the Republicans and some Democrats, because I read about this, try to pass the right to work, to take the rights of the American workers. In Brazil, we have the same attacks. The government tried to pass the labor reform and pension reform in Brazil. Is bad attack. Now, a pension reform is a historical attack in the South America. The proposal of the government in the Brazilian bourgeois is the work necessary, work directly, work in your life 49 years to you have a right to retirement. It's a bad attack because when you have 45 years old, don't have more jobs in Brazil. Because the bourgeois, the companies say, we don't like old men for the work. Yeah, not possible work, have a good jobs in Brazil when you have 45 years old. But the government try, is a pension reform, if you pass this, if your government win, we need to work 49 years. It's impossible. It's incredible. It's a very bad attack in Brazil. In labor reform, the idea of labor reform is breaking. Brazil is knowledge. Is around the world for the best rights. We have the best work rights now in Brazil. An example is for the vacations. I have a privilege. In Brazil, the vacations is 30 days. For vacations, once a year. Every year you have 30 days, 1 month to vacations. Yeah, it's good for us. Yes, it's good. This is most struggles in the past, Brazilian workers fight for this. But like an example, the new labor reform cuts this, cuts for the middle, the right for vacation. Like an example. Now in Brazil, the workers is possible working 44 hours per week. It's Brazilian law. The government broke this. The idea of the new labor reform is increase this for 55. More 10 hours, more 9, more 11 hours per week. This idea of the government is the right, okay, but the problem not is the government is the left or the right. The problem is the companies in Brazil press the government to pass this law. General Motors, Ford, Coca-Cola, because in Brazil the most companies, not a Brazilian companies, is foreign companies. Is Fiat for Italy, Volkswagen for General Motors. These companies in the banks force, press the government to pass this law because these companies, the only way for these companies in my country, like Brazil, like Colombia, Mexico, is like here, is profit, not the life, not for good or health conditions for the workers, but only profits. In the last week, in 15 March 15th. We have big demonstrations in Brazil, the most in the last years, the most demonstrations against this labor reform. Have a day of strike in teachers, a national day of strikes for teachers, postal workers, in longshore workers around Brazil. In many sectors, have a stoppage for 1 or 2 hours. General Motors workers, Volkswagen workers, the unions organize stoppages against these reforms. But not enough. For in Brazil, it's necessary, we try to organize a campaign to call a general strike for next month in April. I'm a member of the CSP Conlutas. CSP Conlutas is a national trade union federation in Brazil. It's a new national trade union federation in Brazil. In Brazil, we have five national trade unions federation. Like FSCO, we have five kinds in Brazil. Is this place? Not so good, but any national trade union federation have ideas. The most national trade unions in Brazil is a bureaucracy, like a FSCO here. It's necessary to fight against the bureaucracy. Because the bureaucracy for CSP Conlutas is like a cancer inside the workers' movement. Because the bureaucracy not excited to the workers to fight against. The bureaucracy have a deals with the companies, not fight for their workers' rights. Because the situation around the world now is a tax for their companies, more attacks, more privatization, more labor reforms. In France, last year's a big struggles against labor reform. This is the same situation around the world. Not in Brazil, labor it had a labor reform. In Colombia, Mexico, education reform the last years, the teachers organized a big strikes against education reform. This is the same situation. Like here, right to work is the same situation. But for this, the only way for the workers is organized to fight back. Don't have your own way. Don't have. Not in the elections. Elections, not the correct way. Because in Brazil, we have a left government for PT Workers' Party, for Lula and Dilma. But in 30 years of PT, the Workers' Party in the power, no change the situation for the workers. No change in these years. Because we the CSP Conlutas call is a new trade union federation. We broken with the main national trade union federation in Brazil. He called CUT. CUT, the main trade union federation in Brazil. The CSP Conlutas is a left part of the CUT. We broken. Since 8 years ago. We broke with CUT and built a CSP Conlutas. And the idea of CSP Conlutas is only two important things. Only is fight back. Fight back. The way for the workers is fight back. The other important idea is democracy. Because if you don't have democracy for the workers, not is possible the workers fight, have a good fight. This is idea for the oldest movement. So the oldest workers' movement in the Europe have this idea: fight in democracy, to fight against the bureaucracy, to fight against the companies. This is the idea for CSP Conlutas. An example of this, because to say is beautiful, okay, but it's necessary to put in practice. One example of this practice of the CSP Conlutas is don't have a national board. It's a national trade union federation. We represent more than 300 unions in Brazil. It's a big federation. Not most big, but it's a big national federation in Brazil. We represent a national professors of universities in Brazil, metal workers, teachers of high schools in São Paulo, Rio de Janeiro, important cities in Brazil, public workers for the governments in Brazil. The CSP Conlutas represent these workers, but don't have a national board of CSP Conlutas. The national board of CSP Conlutas is the assembly. We have assembly in two months we have a national assembly. I don't know this word in English, but we have a national assembly in São Paulo or Rio de Janeiro, the most important in Brazil. Every 2 months, I remember the word, every Every 2 months we have a national meeting, like a national assembly. This meeting, the unions send your representative, your delegates for this meeting. This delegate is possible, the union change for elections. The union elected your representative for the national meeting. This national meeting, every 2 months, is the border of CSP Conlutas. This national meeting take decisions about campaigns, about struggles, about international solidarity. This idea of CSP Conlutas is different idea. It's very different. This idea is inspired for I don't remember the word, but this idea is the same idea of the organization of the revolutionary activists in Ecuador and in Bolivia that puts together workers of unions and labor and social movements. Black movement in the Caucasus, women's movement, LGBT, put the fighters in the same space. This is idea in CSP Conlutas. Put in the same space, in a democratic space, unionists and social movements. Landless, because in Brazil have a big problem with the land, don't have a reform for the lands. Homeless in Brazil. The CSP Conlutas represent the black workers in the caucus of this. They have a power, have a right to voice, the right to vote inside the CSP Conlutas women's movement. Because the idea, the capitalism changed in these last years. The neoliberalism changed. But it's necessary the labor movement changed, also changed. It's necessary to put in the same space organized workers and non-organized workers, like a movement, exploitation, oppressed and exploiting the workers. This idea of CSP Conlutas, and I'm so glad to possible to share us experience of you. United States have other traditionals in the social movement is different to Brazil. In any countries have a different traditionals, but I think the good idea for the United States is meeting like this.
Yeah.
This meeting is a victory. It's possible. This meeting not a small or big or medium. Not important for us. See, if here have a 20, 10 or 1,000 people. No, the important is idea. The CSP Conlutas born in the same situation. The CSP Conlutas born with a little group of metal workers and public workers, like here, public workers in Brazil, because in 2030, the Lula, in the first year of the government Lula, tried to make a labor, a pension reform for only public workers, only for public. Only this situation, public workers and metal workers in a meeting like this, in a meeting like this, take the idea of to organize the rank and file workers, activists to take have the same idea, fight against the government, fight against the company, because and now we have is 50 years ago, this idea of CSP Conlutas. Now we have this idea, we have a CSP Conlutas, we have a national congress in next October. I'd like to invite, if it's possible, to visit Brazil, to visit our congress. And in English, but it's possible in the congress. We have 3,000 delegates elected in the rank and file meetings, because this is the statute. This is statute of CSP Conlutas. This is necessary to elect delegates in the rank and file meetings. It's possible 3,000 delegates to organize the struggles in Brazil against labor reform, against the attacks, and building more and increasing in Brazil the idea of the independence movements against the government. But we so glad to be here. I think I told with Steve in San Francisco. Steve was in a demonstration in solidarity with Suzuki workers in India embassy in San Francisco, and told to Steve, it's necessary that American workers have our own way, the way for independent social movement, independent of the bureaucracy, to increase your struggles, because the victory for the workers here is very important for the workers. An example, when the Trump inauguration and in the after Trump inauguration had a big demonstrations for the women's, the unionists, the Brazilian people say, wow, this is United States, really? This, the leftists don't worry, because they don't believe it. The left, wow, it's United States. We can make the same here in Brazil. Yeah, I think the same women, the same unionists in Argentina, South Africa, India, same things. Because American leaders here, unionists here, you have the most important for the international labor movement. Because CSP Conlutas support the idea of this meeting. CSP Conlutas and my international network, CSP Conlutas is part of an international network, not a UNIF international, because a UNIF federation is most bureaucracy. But we support the idea for organizing workers and organize meetings like this for organize the independent activists and fighting activists like this. I hope have more than meetings like this. I hope. Thanks so much. in the table we have a magazine in English. We translate to English. We write about the history of CSP Conlutas, the Earth experience. And we have two invites. One invite is to CSP Conlutas Congress in October, and another invite is to the first meeting of International Network of Struggle and Solidarity of Americas. The idea is make a meeting in São Paulo after the Congress, the CSP Conlutas Congress, have organizations of Canada, to here, United States, possible teachers and longshore workers to San Francisco, because these friends have a participation in a committee, the name is the Labor Rise Against Trump, will participate in the Congress in this international meeting. I would like to invite you to. Thanks so much.
As people have already said before, these are the kinds of things that we need to be doing. I am a former co-president of a graduate employees organization, Local 6300, current officer at large. And so you heard some of the GEO members speaking earlier, and a lot of what people have been saying today has really resonated in the sense that there are things that need to be done. But the question remains, and the things I study in my work, I study social movements. I study how people resist. I study how it changes throughout history. I study how do we determine resistance mechanisms today, especially since capital has completely shifted geographic locations, has changed the mode of production to where the factory, the shop floor, these areas, these aren't the spaces that we engage in as much anymore because of what capital's been doing. So the question remains, how do we organize? And so I'm not going to be talking so much about communication as much as I'm going to be talking about strategies of resistance. Because my big thing is that we take the history, we take the current moment, we analyze it, and we use it to build objectives to fight for. Because that's where we are at this point. The idea is mobilization versus organization. Now, one of the things that we have to understand is that when you organize, and I get a lot of this because I read a lot of social movement theory, you know, the Alvin Morris, who wrote the greatest book on social movements, The Origins of the Civil Rights Movement. And he doesn't talk much about the civil rights movement itself, but he talks about how they were able to build something. And one of the biggest things he recognizes is that we have to determine the difference between mobilization and organization. When you mobilize, you get people together for a particular instance, but it's not as political as it should be. Whereas in organizing, you develop a relationship with different groups of people through talking. It's what Aaron Edmonds said earlier today. You have a relational meeting with somebody and you get to know each other. You put everything on the line for somebody else, and that's how you organize. That's the difference. The people get together, they engage in struggle together, and they build something together. Whereas in mobilizing, social media, text messaging alerts, you know, it's not very direct. It's a very indirect way of doing things. And unfortunately, the national media promotes the mobilization more so than the organizing to, of course, disrupt what we want to do. They don't want us talking to each other. They understand what talking does. Talking builds solidarity. Talking builds relationships. Because when it comes down to the line, and when you have incidents of strikes or other labor militancy, you tell people that I'm going to lay my life on the line or my job on the line for you. They understand that that is the greatest power that workers have, and they refuse to allow that to happen. So the question is, you know, we all keep talking about how do we organize. You know, everybody keeps saying we're going to organize, we're going to build these things. There are certain strategies that you can take back to your locals, and one of the things, and so I have about 3 or 4 points I'm going to make. The first one being that we have to understand that ideology must matter. You know, there are still people who are surprised that Rauner is doing what he does. People are really surprised that Rauner is holding the state hostage and refusing to recognize workers' rights. People are surprised when Trump does the things that he does. But it's been proven throughout history, and my football coach used to tell me this all the time, that you are what you repeatedly do. Donald Trump and Bruce Rauner are both capitalists. How do capitalists see workers? They see them as commodities to exploit. They have no respect for them. That's why they don't care about, you know, one of the funniest things I read yesterday when the healthcare bill collapsed. They talked to 12 people that were in the room with Trump. All of them said that Trump didn't even read the bill. He had no idea what was in the Republican Healthcare Act. He didn't care, he just wanted it passed because he doesn't have any type of recognition of what people need to survive. And that's what the ruling group is doing right now, the oligarchs are doing right now, is they're setting up this standard of not being able to deal with the problems that the people of the working class are dealing with. I'm just being honest. And we have to be very clear about that. That's why ideology matters. You have the conservatives who will clearly state to you, I don't care about you. You have the liberals who will say, well, I care about certain things about you, like your identity, but I can care less about your material problems. And then you have the radicals, you have the people in this room who really want to change something. So we gotta understand, even if you aren't a socialist, embracing socialist principles are very important to building something. And we're talking about unity. We talk about solidarity. We talk about kinship networks. We talk about pooling resources. These are socialist principles. You don't have to necessarily be a socialist because everybody says, I don't want to be a socialist. But we do it anyway. We share things. That's socialism. And when we embrace that in our unions, if we know that somebody is having trouble with their electricity, if somebody's having trouble paying their rent, then we do what Carol Stack did in her amazing book, All Our Kin, where they actually set up to where I'm going to pay your rent or this amount of money for your rent this month, and you pay mine next month. That type of networking, but you do it in different ways, but that's the way we start building real solidarity, is that we set up these kinship networks, and we do it through our ideology, which is socialist in principle. We have to understand that. And the reason why we have to do that is because we've been talking about the media. We've been talking about the three major, and this is from Antonio Gramsci, the three major cultural institutions that we have to change to really do something is education, the media, and the church. Those are the three controlling cultural institutions in this country and worldwide as well. The problem is that the liberals control all three of those. Now, we have to be clear what the liberal, when we say what liberal is, it's liberalism. We have to understand there are five strands to why liberal reformism is hurting the labor movement. Number one, it is devoid of criticism of the political economy. It does not consider the material conditions of the people. Number two, it's hierarchical in how it approaches oppressed groups. Instead of being horizontal, meaning that we all have different issues, but we're all struggling together, one group is more important than the other. That's how the liberals do it. Number three, they are opposed to militant, resistant tactics. They talk down on people who engage in urban rebellion. They don't like labor strikes, and they surely do not support when neighborhood community groups to form self-defense groups. Number four, they possess no legitimate ties to international working class struggles against war and imperialism, which is, we know that those things are directly tied to our oppression as laborers in this country. And number five, is dedicated solely to electoral politics, symbolic protest, and capital investment as the solutions to social ills. In other words, identity politics. Now we have to understand what exactly identity politics is. Identity politics is inherently counterproductive to building any type of socialist principle because it disguises this objectively right-wing neoliberal ideology with this superficially progressive politics centered on social constructs. Now I'm not condemning current movements for social equality. Instead, I argue that when the liberals interpret the social realities of the oppressed, they actively suppress the role of the structure, which is capital accumulation, in creating and maintaining these social constructs. When you interpret race, gender, and sexual discrimination, you must analyze it in a genuine intersectional manner, which means that it is linked to the material conditions of which they are constituted. That's the reason why the ruling class created these constructs, is to divide workers. And that should be at the center of how we talk to our laborers. This is how, when we have labor meetings in our locals, we have to continue to talk about these things and have these discussions to dispel a lot of the mess. Because right now, as long as the liberals continue to control the media, the church, and the education systems, the material is going to continue to get pushed to the side. And we can't let that happen. We have to understand that the material is the thing that ties us together as workers in struggle. And that's what has to be at the center. Now, again, we have to be careful too now. On the flip side, we gotta watch those class reductionist people now, because they're out there. The ones that say it's only about class, nothing else matters. And we know that's not true. We know that there are racially, gender discrimination tactics that are targeted at specific groups. You can look at the mortgage crisis of the Great Recession. They targeted African-American working class and poor people directly with those ridiculous loans, those home ownership loans. So again, we have to understand that there's a balance that has to be made there, but the material must be central. Now, the next step we have to do is we have to know where we live and we have to understand our moment. Gather data. Gather data of the places where we live and the places where we work. We need to know the labor participation rates of all the places we live, race, age, sex, gender, breakdown of different types of labor, etc. Because, you know, you don't ever see the liberal media doesn't report on labor participation rate, which is actually the real unemployment rate and not the mess that they put out from the Bureau of Labor Statistics. Labor participation rate, by the way, is close to about 67% right now. So that means that 33% of able-bodied people cannot find work in this country, who are actively seeking work. And that doesn't even include the ones who have no longer continued to seek work. So that's the kind of thing we need to know about our local areas. We need to gather data and put together a report of what our conditions are currently. What we know, the types of wage structures that they have, Housing, is housing a current problem? Community issues like police and education, etc. I mean, these are the things that are not only going to strengthen the union, but they're also going to bring the community involved in it, because that's how you get people involved. When they feel like this is something that is going to transform my life, then this is something that I can get involved in, and you're going to start seeing swelling of your union meetings, which should be open to the community as well. Because again, that's how you build solidarity. There has to be some type of push saying, I'm going to come forward. If you look at the historical record of labor movements, there has been a major problem in community organizing. Now, of course, you have a couple of examples here and there that happened throughout history in the 20th century, but most labor organizations, and you can hit up Gompers and a few others for this, did not believe in organizing in the community, particularly in African-American communities. So this is something that we have to address head on. Now, I've heard a lot of talk about the Democratic Party. Once we have the data, and we've done this here, David Johnson was a part of this with me, but we've actually looked at data in terms of the labor participation rate and other issues here, and it has come to our conclusion that the Democratic Party, they do not hold the same interests as laborers. I'm just going to be bluntly honest about it, and we can no longer work with the Democratic Party. And I understand that people want to say that, well, the Republicans are worse, but the thing is that are you either going to get a hard turd or you're going to get a runny turd? But it's still shit. And I'm just being honest with you. We as laborers, exactly, we are at a point now. You got to understand, this is what I do. I look at the data, and every month, our survival is really on the line. Housing, food. I mean, seriously, how many food deserts are rising everywhere now? The types of wage theft that's going on now is at unheard of levels. One of my professors, Sundiata Chajua, calls this the new nadir. Meaning this is the lowest point that we've been at in terms of our resources. We are losing our ability to own our own stuff. Home ownership is plummeting. Schools are plummeting. I mean, we are at survival mode at this point. And so the Democratic Party has had decades to prove that their interests match our interests. And they have failed. So how much more time are we going to give them? Because they're not going to change. You are what you repeatedly do. And that's who the Democratic Party is. And so one of the things that we have to understand is that there are greener pastures. And this is something that you take to your membership during your meetings. There's nothing wrong with thinking alternatively. Because that's the thing that I come across in all my organizations is that they say that what we think about, because I am a socialist, that the idea is infeasible. Something outside of capitalism, something outside of the Democratic Party, it's infeasible. You can't even think of something like that. We have to understand that if we could get just a few people to think alternatively about something different, then we can have some serious change. It's just the first step of getting people to say, maybe there's something different. That's what we have to get across. And how do we do that? Through the material. Put the material at the center. If you keep showing over and over again that this is how we're living, this is not how we should be living, it used to be different, it can be different, people will start to say that this thing that we have going on cannot be saved. We have to do something differently. Two-party system does not work. It only crushes us, and it makes us choose somebody that's not as bad as the other person. But our lives are the ones that continue to deteriorate. The only way that people see this in our local, because you can't just preach at people, you can't just lecture to them, is if you have the report. You do that, you get the data, you have people. If you have schools around, particularly you can get the high schools involved by asking some of the teachers if their students are willing to do this type of research or study for a project or something, or get some of the retired people in the neighborhood to also help with this project to get the data done. Because again, the data's not gonna lie. Every time we looked at it, and this is why the best thing about radicals read conservative, liberal, and radical stuff, so we know that everything is always gonna skew in favor of us because it's the truth, whereas in liberals and conservatives refuse to read that stuff. They base their stuff on alternative facts, and we can't live that way. So again, using the neighborhood or community to build these reports to show different people that may not be on the fence about, I don't know if I want to be an organizer, I don't know if I want to be active, and you use that to say, okay, well, how about we look at your conditions? How are your wages matching up? What's going on with your health care in relation to what's happened since 2012? I mean, you know, just that's one of the talking points that you can start getting people interested, because when you talk about the material, you talk about the way somebody lives their life, and everybody wants to have better lives because we are all oppressed. So that's something to get people going. Now, last point on this, our local rank and file. One of the biggest things that if you listen to our show, The World Labor Hour, is we are constantly criticizing national labor leadership. I'm gonna be honest with you, our local rank and file must hold our national leadership accountable for their passive responses to repeated assaults on labor. The rank and file can retain control of our unions if we engage in more militant actions and discourse when our national leadership foregoes our voices and concedes to austerity. Because that's what's been happening repeatedly. We need hell raisers. We need to be angry. We need to be organized. And while the workerist movement in South Africa in the 1960s and 70s was extremely problematic because it was class reductionist, the one thing that they did in the workerist movement is they made sure that no leader was elected who had not been a part of the rank and file. And they also made sure that no leader could ever speak without the permission of the rank and file. Everything they said, and when they did, when they spoke outside of what the rank and file wanted, they were immediately gone. There was no, in other words, what I'm saying is that there is a lack of respect amongst the national leadership and the rank and file to this day. And the only way that we're going to rectify that, because these are corporate people who are put in positions that make them $500,000 a year or more, and they're sitting there, and they have never been, I mean, I never saw Trump get in a mine. Never saw him. But he became the president of the mine workers and never had the experience of working in those mines. So when the mine workers told them that I cannot put food on my family's table, and he could not understand that, they can't conceive it because they never had the experience of the workers. So if you were not a rank and file member, you've never worked in that particular labor position, you should not be in charge of the workers' conditions. Now, a lot of people consider this to be controversial because, again, it's very difficult to remove a leader from a position due to a lot of constitutional constraints. But there has to be some sacrifices made if we're going to regain control of our unions. There has to be an internal rebellion. The rank and file members have to say that we no longer follow this particular leader, and we're going to rewrite our constitution, we're going to form new unions. Because, I mean, that's really the only way we're going now. Day after day, we see these union leaders and the national leaders have playing golf with these business people, going on trips, sitting in offices with them, never meeting with their rank and file members. This has to stop, or else we are going to continue to be at the behest of the control of entities who have no care about how we live our lives. And if they've never been there with you, they're not going to fight with you. It's just never going to happen. This is something that you've seen throughout history. I'm not cool with you until I fight with you. Plain and simple. And we need fighters. We need fighters. And the best thing about it is education. Education. We must bring back political education sessions to union halls that detail both the current struggles, but also the histories of our struggles, so that union members develop an identity to that particular struggle. You gotta understand what Aaron said earlier about people actually coming in and saying, I paid my dues, that's all I need to do. You serve the union. There is a detachment of new membership that comes in and expects that all they need to do is pay dues. No, the new union leadership, at the beginning of every meeting, there should be at least a 20 to 30 minute session of political education of the current issues and also a historical story of why this union is important. If you don't understand why the union is important, when it's time to fight, when it's time to get on that picket line and risk your life and risk your jobs, because believe me, with Trump in office, he's going to tell police to start shooting picketers. This is not, yeah, we're going back to old 1880s time picketing now. That's why he's putting all that money on the police. So when you put people on a picket line, they need to understand why they're gonna stand up there. It's because I love my union and what it has done. And they need that attachment through historical stories. So take this back to your locals and tell them, I want a union meeting where we have at least 25, 35 minutes of political education for these new people, and also for me, just to get that reconnection back of why I joined this union in the first place. It's not just for the healthcare. It's not just for the education. I mean, it's not just for the wages, et cetera. It's really about this relationship to struggle that is historic in the working people of this country. So that's something that you can take back with you. So again, I just wanted to go over things that you could kind of think about and take back to your locals and say that this is a way that we can start changing things, because it's a long process. It's gonna take years, possibly decades, to where we get to that point to where there is a revolutionary principle amongst working people to say, we're not gonna let you abuse us anymore whatsoever, but it's gonna start. It's gonna start now. It's gonna start with us. You're gonna see that change happening. Even though it's a long process, you're gonna see it and it's gonna feel amazing. Your quality of life is going to skyrocket. The relationships with people you're gonna have are gonna be amazing. And all that comes through struggle. And we should not look down upon that. We are workers and we are survivors. And this is the way we're gonna fight. So take that back to your locals, and we'll continue to have more meetings like this to go over even more concrete strategies. All right, thank you. Power to the people.
Just came from Chicago. A lot's going on. I'm going to play a video if we can get it to work. A few things to bring up. So first of all, my name's Erek Slater. I'm a bus operator, a bus driver for the Chicago Transit Authority for almost 11 years now. I have been elected by my coworkers to be an executive board member for the Amalgamated Transit Union Local 241. That was 2 years ago. We just had another election, and we were re-elected overwhelmingly for that position. And during the last administration, last 2 years, I was illegally fired by the employer for doing union work and also political work. And we're gonna show a little video of that, if it can work, about that fight. And we were able to win a campaign to win the job back, which was an international campaign all the way from Brazil, which we have some of our comrades are here from Brazil also gonna speak, Eduardo and Fabio in the back there later. And also in Korea and Japan, and we got support from many unionists and workers from many of these countries. So I'm gonna briefly talk about that, but I wanna first talk about my coworkers. My union represents about 10,000 working families, about 6,000 of the operations workers, mostly bus operators, but also maintenance workers and clerical workers who operate the vehicles and make sure that the Chicago Transit Authority works, especially on the bus side. We also have about 4,000 retired workers that our union is part of. I want to make clear that I speak for myself. I don't represent here. I do wear the shirt for a representative for identification purposes of the Amalgamated Transit Union, but I don't represent or speak for the views of all the executive board or our union. Also, the Chicago Transit Authority, just have to say, I'm a bus driver for the CTA, but I don't speak for that organization. Just gotta get that out of the way before they fire me and put me in jail. They certainly already fired me a few times. Okay, so, all right, so we were the second largest system in the United States behind New York. It's a major operation. My bus garage, which I am the executive board member and basically chief steward, has about 600 bus driver families and about 100 maintenance workers. And we're worked very hard. So the amount of transportation we move is as big as a major city in the United States. So we have 7 different bus garages in the region, in the Chicago greater region, and about 3 regional PACE suburban buses. You guys may actually get some of them, maybe not this far south, but in the Chicago region. And we represent those workers, that's what the union is. But wow, we're amazing. If just my workplace were to have a slowdown or a shutdown, the whole Chicago city may get stopped. And they're very afraid of that, the city ruling class and the mayor, the managers that do their bidding. So they're very consciously disrupting our union and our ability to organize and to come together. So a few things that we do. So we're mostly black. Most of us come from the south side of Chicago, about 80-90% of us. We have a good percentage of Latino workers in my bus garage. But a lot of us have to go all the way from the south side, all the way from Indiana, to come to this bus garage on the north side of Chicago. And it means we have a long day. We start an hour or 2 hours to get to work. We're driving in our car in traffic. Then we get on a bus and drive in traffic for 3 or 4 or 5 hours. Then we have a long, unpaid break called a swing shift. And we often sit in our car in the parking lot in the garage and try to get some sleep. Or we sit in the garage and play some dominoes or cards or whatever. But then we do the second rush hour. And very stressed, you imagine all those things you know about a public transit bus driver, the violence against us, the stress, the physical injuries. It's worse than many of you may know, and I'll talk about that in a minute. We get on the bus for another 4, 5, 6 hours, and then we're done with the day. And it's been 15, 16, 17 hours. We're technically 13, but by the time you get back home, it's been a very long day. I'm sure a lot of you guys face this in your workplaces as well. And then we might get 6 or 8 hours of sleep. We might put the kid to sleep, you know, take our uniform off, take a shower, and then we're back at it again. And it very feels like we're a slave to the bus. We use those things. We're a slave to the company. They own us. I used to joke before I was married that I'd say to a date I had, I said, you know, you want to go out on Friday night? And she'd ask me, and I'd say, well, CTA, you know, she got Sita. Who is Sita? Right? Is this somebody two times with me? And I said, no, she's not really a girlfriend. She's more like a wife, right? she owns as much. I don't have any time other than to work, and we don't have much of our own time. And that's a big problem. We have they're constantly trying to put us in the workplace, even when we're not paid. A lot of the problems you have is. Some of the federal regulations, like FMLA, Family Medical Leave Act, they send people to harass us. They send private investigators. They accuse us of falsification. They're on a massive firing campaign. They want to transform the workplace into a high turnover, right? So instead of having a long career of 20, 30 years as a bus operator, as we expect, right? Because you want someone who knows what they're doing, because you're transporting human lives. In the middle of a megalopolis, in a major city, in the rush hour, you'd like them to have 5 years experience or so, because it ain't no joke. But now they want to have people in, they want to fire everyone with seniority so they don't get a pension. They want to threaten and make us fearful of our jobs so we don't organize and fight back. And they've, to a degree, been successful. However, we've had a few good fight back campaigns this past 2 years. They were trying to take away our day off. There's a big split between our workplace between part-time and full-time workers. You probably heard this, contracting, part-time. They got about 25 or more of us on the property that are on part-time. Basically, it's just a scam to make it so we don't get a pension. It's a scam so they can lower our working conditions and pay us less while we're doing the same thing. We have the same badge number, same clothing, same uniform on. And so they pit us against each other between part-time and full-time. We've been able to fight back. They've tried to go after the part-time workers by taking away their days off, making it so that you're on call every day. Even the days you're scheduled to be off with your family, they say, you have to call in case we need you, right? You're literally on call all of your career for years. And we were able to push that back with some mobilization within my garage. A few other things, I'll talk briefly about my case. Hopefully you can get this up. I can't speak better than my coworkers. Who spoke up publicly in a press conference that we had when I was fired. We actually took over the Chicago Transit Authority. We didn't take it over, but we stepped inside and we had a press conference actually on the company building, right? We went inside, they confronted us, and we said, who are you? We're gonna have a conference right here. And workers spoke up in uniform in front of the press. you know, because they could get fired for wearing this uniform, and said, this is wrong, shouldn't have done that. Then we had union officials and so on. And from that, man, it's been an explosive campaign. The video that hopefully we'll get to show you went viral, and about 10 to 15,000 hits on it. It was all this kind of excitement. We're finally fighting back. Then we were able to get a coalition of different organizations, from Black Lives Matter to the Chicago Teachers Union, to a lot of persons with disability, fighters and groups that participated, wanted better public transportation, wanted more jobs in our communities, and they saw this as their struggle too. So they came to our actions and press conferences and so on. We had a major action as part of the Chicago Teachers Union action on April 1st of last year. And Herbert actually was able to go all the way from Brazil, as we had a labor notes conference at that same time. So there's a lot of international trade unionists in town. and we had this day of action in which the teachers struck, Chicago Teachers Union, and some of the workers who do service work also did, the McDonald's workers and so on, the Fight for 15 and the union movement, also had an action the same day. Well, they pivoted over to my garage, because there was a McDonald's on strike 50 feet away from my garage. So a lot of the recent immigrant workers, many from Mexico, came over to my bus garage. And imagine the fear of management when this happened. You had undocumented workers with signs on, Fighting for 15, surrounding the McDonald's that were there. We circled around it. And then floods of teachers and students coming from striking high schools and literally circling the McDonald's. And the cops were around us, but they were backing off. And then we went 50 feet over to the bus garage. And then they had a whole pile of cops at that point. Because they were afraid we were going to do what? What do you think they were afraid we were going to do? Block. I think they were most concerned we were gonna block the exit of the buses. In other words, have a chain and stop the buses from being able to go to the rush hour or come back. And that would be a major strike because people couldn't get to work at that point. Now, that wasn't our intention, but they gave us some good ideas. Their fears gave us some good ideas. So that might be what we do next time. So that was a really good action. We were able to combine many sections of the working class into that fight. Management, this told us time. Again, I'm a member of the Amalgamated Transit Union and I support my union. However, the union officials on top did not support me or my coworkers at my garage. And the workers knew this. They sent letter writing campaigns to the union officials all the way to our international union, which represents 200,000 families in Canada and the United States. They did nothing. Right? The president of the union did nothing. Workers stepped up and started defending. Well, so all this time they said that you've been fired, right? They fired me for insubordination. I gave an order to a manager to cease and desist from breaking our contract, right? That's what I'm supposed to do. I'm a union shop. We have a contract, which is signed in writing. And you say to the manager, hey, it says right here, you can't do that. Stop it, right? And he says, you can't do that. We run this place. We're going to get you, right? Because we know you're a bus operator. So they tried to trump up charges because they had a worker, and I'll hopefully explain this here, a worker giving out discipline to other workers, tattling on other workers to go to the manager. And he says, that's not my job description. I'm not required to do that. So I started an investigation. They said, get out of here. They fired me a few days later. So while I was fired, since the union only knew how to fight in one way, unfortunately, which is write a grievance, right? Which is the company's thing. They run the grievance system. They say, well, just wait a couple years until you get justice, right? And maybe we'll give you pennies on the dollar. By the time you're desperate to come back, we won't even give you the money we should have given you. Right? That's the game they play, and the union officials, unfortunately, have been playing into that. We said everything else. We said, let's have a strike, right? Because this is an attack. I'm an executive board member of the union they fired, right? This is an attack on the union movement. for doing the work of defending the contract. So unionists understood this around the world, and all kinds of resolutions were sent out from the Caucus of Rank and File Educators, had some great stuff from the Chicago Teachers Union, to all the way to Korea. We had these pictures of the Korean Confederation of Trade Unions, which is one of the most militant worker federations in the world, and they just toppled their government or their president a few weeks ago or a month ago. And they sent out messages of support to my local. So it was amazing support we got immediately, just because this video went viral and we had some connections. So, but at the same time, the management was able to remove the union from the garage. They had police stationed in the bus garage so that I could not come in. So we literally would escort me, or I don't know what else they would do to me, escort me out. Escort me out with the police. And unfortunately, they did the same thing in the union meetings. Right? They would have our executive board meetings, they would trump up, they would shout me down in the meeting and then saying, you're being disruptive, and call the Chicago Police Department. We had riot police, major, serious body armor come into our executive board meeting three times. And one of those times, they removed me improperly. So they wouldn't pay me a cent for the work I was doing, I was required to do by the bylaws and constitution of our union. While at the same time, the management was refusing to abide by labor law and contract, et cetera, by illegally removing the union from the property, et cetera. So we were in this battle, so I had to go out and do my union work by my cell phone, right? And meet workers at the McDonald's or the church's chicken near the garage. And so that's the way I did it. And we had the worker spies, as we call them, making sure whatever management was up to, they would send me information and we'd do it from there. Eventually we started pushing back and they let me back on property one day a week because they wanted me to rubber stamp their discipline against workers. They wanted the union to be officially there. And eventually we were able to come back on property. But it was a long battle for 10 months. And then eventually we won. Through that grievance procedure, we put enough pressure on the union officials to actually put effort into it, and we won the case. We won every single, they tried to put 20 different counts on me, every single one of them. We beat back, and they had to bring me back with all back pay and with all seniority. And this was a victory for workers at the garage. And like I said, we just had an election. We'll start in 1 second. An election for my office. There was three other people running against me. Management was explicitly, publicly supporting the other candidates. The former union officials, I say former because they were voted out of office last week. Right? All those people that, right? I hope we can do better, right? But that shows all the people going forward, if they do not support the union, if they do not do their job, they will get voted out of office by the membership. Okay, so are we ready for this real quick?
Gun, but yet they started me at minimum wage, $8.50 an hour at minimum wage, a Vietnam-era veteran. I lost my business. I came here to work. 2.5 years ago, as a part-timer, I'm still a part-timer. Once I got here, I found out that it is terrible. This man right here, when I came to the garage at North Park, he had meetings explaining to all of us what was going on every day out here on the street, how they can accelerate charges, how all of a sudden, if there's one rule, they said, no, we're going to accelerate that rule, we could fire you now. Even though the rule was for three years, now it's 1 year.
Erek and I started together 10 years ago. I know Erek as a good friend. I think he's one of the best union reps that we've ever had to come along, if not the best one. I was injured on duty, and they fired me because I wouldn't sign a short-term disability. So Erek works with us, as being a co-worker, to help us so these things won't happen, because there's a lot of things going on with CTA that shouldn't be going on.
So my name is Tana Muhammad. I'm the second vice president, 241.
How many years you got?
I'm a 30 year, I've been here for 30 years, going on 28 years as a bus operator. And we know all the infractions, all the things that CTA has put up on us as operators, and I stand with Erek as well as all of the officers. We stand behind Erek, and I just want to let him know that we are in his corner as officers. And as I say, I'm here to speak, to stand with them, and we're going to do all we can to, if anything should happen, we're here.
Good morning. My name is Charlie Peacock. I am the first vice president of Local 308, the sister of Local 241. We're here in solidarity with our brother Erek to show that if you attack one of our locals, you attack all of our locals. Also, in our contract, we have a clause 223 dealing with affiliation. The authority will neither discharge nor discriminate against an employee covered by this agreement because of his or her connection with Local 241 or 308. So clearly, that is a violation of our contract. And once again, Local 308 stands firmly behind it.
He sees that public services are under attack in the city, both for bus drivers, for train drivers, and for teachers, and that we were having a meeting off-site at a McDonald's near the North Park bus barn in order to talk with bus drivers about our common issues, about how we need more money for the schools and more money for public transportation. And the bus drivers at Kingo said management was intimidating people from coming, and apparently they're attacking. I'm not surprised at all that they would attack somebody who wants to defend public services and who wants to draw the connections between our struggles. We teachers are in a struggle right now with Mayor Emanuel, and apparently they're attacking Erek for pointing that out to his coworkers. What's happening to Erek today is an unlawful and severe escalation of management's divide and conquer strategy. It began at the beginning of this year when management tried barring union members from exercising their First Amendment right and their rights under the Labor Act to distribute flyers for Chuy Garcia. The federal court gave a preliminary injunction against that unlawful command. What we've experienced since then is a campaign to divide bus workers from teachers. The substance of Erek's unfair labor practice charge is that the CTA management has been prohibiting bus workers from putting up flyers, from holding meetings in break rooms to discuss support for teacher bargaining. If management can get away with these kinds of actions, if management can get away with terminating an executive board member in the middle of bus driver bargaining, who's supporting bus drivers as strongly as anybody I know, and who's supporting teachers as strongly as anybody I know, that's going to have a terrible impact on the First Amendment rights of any bus driver at CTA, and it's also going to impact the public, because the public has a right to hear the opinions of public employees on how to improve the service to people who ride public transit and how to improve the service of our public education system.
That's the end of it.
Okay.
So, real quick, I don't support Chuy Garcia, to be clear on that. But our union did win an injunction. The international union came in pretty hard in support of that candidate. And we won an injunction, which actually was positive, that we were able to do political work on the property. And that was positive. He brought that in partially. Anyway, that was one of the lawyers working on. That case he brought up, a year and a half ago, or whatever it was, is still going to court. Next week, in 2 weeks from now or so, on the 10th of April, we'll hopefully get final justice on that case he's discussing. We'll get our union office back, which they illegally removed, and get the right to have meetings in the workplace clarified in writing. So these are all battles that workers have participated and come into the streets to win. The main point I'm trying to say coming here is that if you stand up and you fight, you can win. And management will come after you, the city administration, or wherever you are, will come after you. But if you make it public, you have a principled stand, you can get a ton of support from the labor movement and the working class You know, I joke, I kind of make fun of the managers in the garage. I say, come at me. I'd like another vacation because you all had to pay me every day. And I went to Brazil and met some of the most impressive revolutionists I've ever met in the world. I went to Korea, and they had 1 million people on the streets, and they ended up toppling their government, this hated government that was going after the labor laws and making things worse for the workers in that country. Great. You know, I said it from day one. Every minute or every day you remove me from my coworkers, I'm going to make you pay 10 times more. Right? You're going to want me in the garage organizing my coworkers, because I'll be out there with a press conference outside. I'll be out there with three other unions, and we'll make the political price that much higher every time you try to take away our democratic space.
Mom, I have been doing this for a long time, way before I started working at Ford. And I've been a union member or associated with association even through my military career, which was, believe it or not, the NCOs have NCOA association. So they do have a membership. The small groups like Move On, Take Action, Black Lives Matters, those are the groups that we need. The unions have a hard time supporting these groups, saying that they are violent, they just don't want to throw no money out for some reason. But they, believe it or not, they are doing the work that we should be doing. They are the ones in front of the places on civil disobedience, closing the places down. Our leadership, our international leadership, they won't do it because it's pussy. You know, they don't want to be seen or arrested. But we need to support these small groups. I mean, they got one coming up on the 30, you know, downtown, so it's a rally. We need to be there. We need to be there full force. If you know somebody that's not doing anything, just go downtown. If nothing else, you can do some shopping. But you need to be down there to support. And it's high school student. I went to a Black Lives Matter meeting, and believe it or not, it was 90% white. Mm-hmm. And it made me scratch my head. Because they doing something. I mean, college kids from Winnetka, Evanston, you know, you wouldn't dare think that they would be involved. They cared more about their issues than we did.
Yeah.
And we were the ones that suffered. I was the one that was suffering. It was amazing. This is the stuff that we need to do. We need to support these groups. All right, thanks.
Cottage, I'm Local 551 member. I'm third generation UAW member. I just want to briefly talk about something, what needs to come together. And I call it the three C's. You have to have compassion for what it is we do, and that comes from the spirit. You have to have courage for what it is we do, and you have to be consistent with that. See, I'm compelled to do what I did because of what my daddy done. You understand? So it's in me. And I have courage because I'm Phyllis, and I never liked bullies anyway. See, these companies are bullies. But I understand one thing about these bullies. They're addicts. Their drug of choice is money. You understand? One thing I know about addicts, and I know about addicts, and I know about drugs. You take away the drug from the addict, what they do is they start to go into, they get sick, they get ill. What they call it? They call it something, I forget. What they call it. They go through withdrawals. You understand? But it's warriors like us, man, that stand for people that's too scared to stand for themselves until they come to the realization that we all need to stand together because there's power in numbers, because we're not out-organized, man. We're not outnumbered, we're out-organized. You understand? And it's not really what we doing that matters, man. It's why we do what we do, because it's the right damn thing to do. You understand? It's about unity, man. The root word to that is union. and we want to help the communities. And just listen to that word, come unity. You understand? I want to be a part of something much greater than myself, man. For real. Local 551.